Welcome to Essays on Frame. On this episode, we take a fresh look at the Paul Thomas Anderson classic, Boogie Nights. Now, Boogie Nights is more an experience than just a film. A true ensemble piece, it relies on P.T. Anderson's ability as a filmmaker to create a story that both respects the unique journeys of each figure, while also maintaining sight of the film's broader narrative arc. And PTA weaves in and out of these characters' lives with such dexterity that you often forget you're watching a film that's ostensibly about the porn industry. And that's because it really isn't. The strength of Boogie Nights, and why I think it's endured these past two decades, relies upon the fact that the film's audacious subject matter is nothing more than an intriguing backdrop. Instead of depending on it, PTA employs this setting as a canvas through which the film can explore broader themes of family, acceptance, and redemption. Boogie Nights builds its narrative around one main character, sure, but it also allows those who come into contact with that character to have their own respective arcs. PTA endears us to each individual by showing that they have their own troubles, their own ambitions, and it's this narrative ripple effect that powers the film. So the question is, how do you do it? Much has been said about the film's cinematography, its brilliant collection of period-specific music, even its ambitious casting, and all deserve high praise, but I'm here to argue that the film works because it builds upon the foundational genre of storytelling, that of the coming-of-age narrative. Simply put, Boogie Nights is nothing more than an unorthodox Bildungsroman. Hear me out. The term Bildungsroman was first introduced by German philosopher and sociologist Wilhelm Dilthey in 1870, and found its way into the English vernacular in the decades to follow. According to Merriam-Webster, the Bildungsroman is defined as the combination of two German words, Bildung, meaning education, and Roman, meaning novel. It deals with the formative years of a main character, and in recent years the term has begun to define films that deal with the youthful character's coming of age. Sound familiar?
Eddie Adams from Torrance.
Exactly. Now seems like a great time to point out that the original concept for Boogie Nights stems from a 32-minute short film titled The Dirk Diggler Story. It's a film that PTA wrote when he was just 17 years old. I point this out because A, that's incredibly impressive, and B, at such a young age, the coming-of-age story would be a natural structure through which to build a narrative. Okay, it might be helpful to break down the main tenets of a traditional Bildungsroman, and with some help from Quizlet, here goes. The traditional coming-of-age story is broken down into six loose categories: inexperience, call to adventure, painful lessons, the change, homecoming, and reflection. Inexperience. The protagonist begins the story as an inexperienced youth. In Boogie Nights, we meet Eddie Adams as a shy busboy cleaning dishes at an area nightclub. He isn't in school, his home life leaves much to be desired, and he wants more out of his life.
I want you to know I plan on being a star. Big bright shining star.
He hasn't found the exact means through which that next step can be taken. Until, that is, the call to adventure, where the protagonist must choose to leave the safety of their home and begin the journey to coming of age. In this case, Eddie meets Jack, played by Burt Reynolds. Their first meeting introduces Eddie to a new and exciting world, but it doesn't cement the formal call to adventure. This doesn't happen until Eddie has a confrontation with his mother, forcing him out of his comfort zone in exchange for a turn in the spotlight. Painful lessons. Painful lessons in Boogie Nights is essentially the second act of the film. The protagonist has a series of adventures and must learn many difficult lessons about life. Eddie becomes Dirk Diggler, his career in the industry unfolds, he's introduced to new people, introduced to new vices, and suffers a major loss. By the time the film pushes into the 80s, Dirk's flaws are in full view. He's arrogant, addicted, and headed down a path of ruin. The change. When the protagonist overcomes their central conflict and changes, which happens at this exact point in the film. But we'll come back to this scene in a moment. Then there's the homecoming, where the protagonist returns home bringing his newfound and often humbling knowledge with him.
I need help, Jack.
The coming-of-age story comes to an end with reflection. This is when the protagonist reflects on their experiences and often looks back with a sense of loss or regret. Which is quite literally this scene. You know, with the mirror, get it? Reflecting one's past with a mirror. Anyway, when rewatching the film through the lens of a Bildungsroman, one couldn't help but draw a comparison to another coming-of-age story, one that parallels the journey of an unorthodox son as he navigates the world of show business, falls into the wrong crowd, is humbled by his own arrogance, and ultimately returns to his family with a newfound understanding of life. That film? Pinocchio. Okay, hear me out. Of course, it isn't a perfect comparison, but there are obvious parallels that can be drawn between the two. For example, Jack can be viewed as two parts Geppetto, one part J. Worthington Foulfellow. Pinocchio's journey as a performer could easily be a mirror of Eddie's transformation into Dirk Diggler, and one could even argue that the Colonel is just a slightly more nuanced version of Stromboli. Yet, let's circle back to the scene in which Dirk and company meet Alfred Molina's character. Aside from being an absolute masterclass in cinematic storytelling, this scene also works as a deconstruction of what worked so well in the 1940 animated film. In fact, it draws strong thematic comparisons to both the scene on Pleasure Island as well as the Belly of the Whale sequence that followed. Complementary scenes that are crucial to the arc of Pinocchio's character in the third act of the film. Visually, the Boogie Nights scene offers a sense of claustrophobia, like we're entering the belly of the whale. In fact, the gate closes, and as we move through the hall, it's as if we're sliding into the belly itself. The room is backlit with blue and green hues, and the rock accents evoke a coral underwater setting. We're essentially stuck in a vulnerable fishbowl. The whale in this instance is the room itself, and all that this reckless series of events comes to represent. The constant arrhythmic popping of the fireworks works in similar fashion to the crashing waves that take place within the whale, creating a tension that carries throughout the sequence. Thematically, Todd Parker is similar to Lampwick, an irredeemable character responsible for pulling the protagonist into this world of vice and folly. Reed Rothschild plays the part of a Jiminy Cricket surrogate, a voice of paranoid reason throughout this entire sequence. The change, at least for Pinocchio, occurs during his experience on Pleasure Island, particularly when he looks on in horror as Lampwick transforms into a donkey. In these traumatizing seconds, Pinocchio understands the consequences of a carefree, morally bankrupt life. In Boogie Nights, this moment of clarity is done with that single shot we spoke of earlier. Lasting nearly 50 seconds, we see that same range of emotions, but in a few subtle flickers of facial movement. Still one of Mark Wahlberg's best moments on screen. The sequence in Boogie Nights builds to a fever pitch, ultimately unraveling into a series of gunshots. This sequence mirrors that of the literal fire set within the bowels of Monstro, destructive acts that ultimately allow both protagonists the chance to escape. By the end of each series of events, both Dirk and Pinocchio have undergone significant change, growing from each intense ordeal into better versions of themselves. In Pinocchio's case, he becomes a real boy, where Dirk finds solace in returning to his work, and each rejoins the families they nearly lost. And here's where Boogie Nights really excels. If you look at Jack's house as a symbol for family, one could argue that all of its inhabitants should, similar to Dirk, endure journeys of their own. PTA focuses the film's attention on Diggler, but the director makes us keenly aware of those around him. They're cautionary tales for a boy on his journey toward manhood. In that way, the film isn't all too different from many of the iconic coming-of-age films we've grown to love over the years. Stand By Me, Dazed and Confused, American Graffiti. Stories that rely as much on their range of characters as they do the time periods within which they live. We may not identify with the trials and tribulations of the late 1970s porn industry, but we definitely understand family. We understand acceptance. Redemption. The Bildungsroman structure has stood the test of time, because it has the power to resonate with everyone. Boogie Nights is a film about that lifelong journey, one that glides in and out of the lives of its characters in the hopes of saying just one thing. Sometimes, all that really matters is the family you choose. Hey, thank you so much for checking out the latest episode of Essays on Frame. Boogie Nights stands as one of my favorite Paul Thomas Anderson films, and this is just a taste of why. We just hit 500 subscribers, so thank you to everyone who decided to join in and be a part of this community. It's great to connect with other people who also love and are passionate about film and filmmaking. We are hoping to do more episodes, more frequently. That's a New Year's resolution of mine, is to do at least 6 episodes this year. So stay tuned, more to come. Thank you so much, and we'll see you later. Feel my
heat. I think we should repeat that again. Feel my heat.
Feel my heat.
Yeah, it's definitely cool.